are our seniors. Dr. Stack.
Thank you, Governor. All right, here's how we see if how things go here. I'm not sure if I have the right version of my slides. Scotty, if you can put up the slides you have, and we'll see if they're the ones I need. So let me talk while she's, there we go. So that's the correct first slide. We'll see if we go along if I have the right one later on. So I want to talk real quickly, or not so quickly, about how we're going to work through phase 1A and then phase 1B and some of the different priorities that are attempting to be addressed and how we hope to work through that. So we go to the next slide, please. So here you'll see we've got about 330 million Americans in our country. We have two vaccines just recently approved for use. The Pfizer is usable for people 16 and over, and Moderna is authorized for people 18 and over. Using round numbers, we have about 250 million Americans who are 18 and older, and we have potentially enough doses of these two vaccines to immunize roughly 50 million people by about March 1. So you can do the math. That means no more than 1 in 5 eligible Americans and fewer than 1 in 5 eligible Americans, more like 1 in 7 Americans overall, since people under 16 are not authorized for the vaccines, can have access between now and March. So it's going to be difficult as we work through this, and we have to set priorities, and we have to set priorities in ways that give the greatest benefit and protection for individuals and society. So next slide, please. I have used a couple slides in here from the Center for Disease Control's Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices. That's what CDC ACIP stands for. Dr. Dooling is one of the experts who has presented at these sessions and is one of the leaders for creating these paradigms for immunization prioritization. Phase 1A includes long-term care facility residents and healthcare personnel. You'll see they put a scale here intentionally to show they are trying to balance preventing morbidity, which is healthcare injury or harm, and mortality, which is death, with the preservation of society's functions and the things we need to do to keep society operating. So they have tried to use this balancing act as they go through these early phases of vaccine deployment. Now for 1A, Kentucky, and I think the vast majority, if not all states across the country, are following this very closely. And this is why we fully activated the CVS and Walgreens federal program that the secretary just spoke about, so we could reach the most vulnerable persons in our state. And I'll emphasize here, nationwide, about 40% of all deaths have occurred in nursing home residents. In Kentucky, perhaps because we've done such a good job protecting the larger population and have fewer deaths overall, we have two-thirds, or about 68% of all of our deaths have occurred in nursing home population residents. And so we have prioritized fully operationalizing that program to protect those vulnerable individuals who are at greatest risk in our state. Healthcare personnel obviously are essential to keeping all of us healthy and well. And when we're sick, we need them to help take care of us. And we've talked repeatedly over the last few months about the difficulties in not having enough healthcare professionals to provide the care we need when the healthcare system gets strained. And so there was really no dispute about these priorities, and there was clear consensus nationally and across the country. If we can do the next slide, please. So on this slide, this is another Dr. Dooling image, and it was from the same meeting. And here's where I'm going to point out some of the challenges. The paradigm of preventing morbidity and mortality and preserving societal functioning starts to get very, very difficult to follow already in phase 1B. So I put these red numbers in here. There's about 3 million long-term care facility residents, we think. There's about 21 million healthcare personnel. That's phase 1A, so that's 24 million people nationwide. Phase 1B, they used people 75 and older. That's about another 21 million people, some of whom live in nursing homes. And then they broke out or subdivided the essential workers category into frontline essential workers and other essential workers because it was so enormous. 87 million Americans, they estimated, in these categories. They kept 30 million of them in categories they defined as frontline essential workers. Now, I told you that there's about 50 million doses potentially available, or 50 million vaccine courses available by March 1st. If you add up all these numbers, you've got probably 70 million people. You do the math. There's not enough to get to all of these people by March with the quantities of vaccine that are projected at the present time. So ACIP acknowledged there would inevitably be a need to make further sub-prioritizations. And that was part of their dialogue. I listened to their hearing when they did this on a Sunday afternoon. This was part of their dialogue. And if you look to 1C, and we're not there yet, the population is staggeringly enormous. If you look at the people 16 to 64 with high-risk medical conditions, more than 110 million people, none of whom are likely to be covered by, obviously, by age. They're not covered by the 75 and older crowd or the long-term care facility residents. So these are really, really enormous buckets. If they weren't further subdivided, there's no way we'd get through these in any kind of orderly or reasonable fashion. Next slide. This is where I may be worried I have the wrong one. Okay. So in Kentucky, on the preventing morbidity and mortality, I want to just show you our specific data for our state. So in our state, people who are 70 and over are about 11% of the total state's population. But these people who are 70 and older, when they get COVID, they have a 3 to 4 times risk of hospitalization compared to the overall population, and they have a nearly 4 times risk of ICU admission. That's what you can see in the top left bar graphs, is that for all ages, it's about 1.2% go in the ICU, and about 5.2% go into the hospital. But the numbers for the people who are between 70 to 79 and 80 and over are much, much higher than the general population. If you look down in the bar graphs in the bottom left, this takes all people who have had COVID in Kentucky who have ever been admitted to the hospital or the ICU, and you can see that the same numbers play out. So about 40% of all of our hospitalizations for COVID are in persons over the age of 70, even though they're only 11% of the population. And for the ICU admissions, it's a little bit, it's about the same actually. So, and then finally, 75% of all of our COVID-19 related deaths in Kentucky have occurred in persons 70 and older. This is clearly the population at greatest risk for serious medical needs requiring hospitalization and intensive care unit care, and also the population at greatest risk for death. So by helping to protect this population, clearly we help to provide them some protection from these great harms. But additionally, it helps to keep people out of the hospital with COVID-19. And then that therefore helps all of us in society, people who have other problems that are not COVID related, such as heart attacks and strokes and appendicitis and a bad gallbladder, all sorts of other things you need to have taken care of, rely on having hospitals and healthcare settings with sufficient capacity to meet your needs. And to the extent we can keep people with COVID who are seriously ill from filling the hospitals, we can keep other people having access to the care they need and keep the rest of society open for business and operating. Next slide. Let's see if this is the right or wrong one. There we go. That's good. Thank you very much, Scotty. You got it right. So this is a summary now of what we are going to do in Kentucky for phase 1A, which I've already talked about, and phase 1B. So again, for phase 1A, and I broke it out for clarity here, long-term care facility, that's LTCF, is what we usually would call a nursing home. And then ALF is an assisted living facility. That would be, well, that's self-explanatory. And both of those populations were included in the federal program with CVS and Walgreens. And so we fully activated those programs. Healthcare personnel, and I just sent a memorandum out today to all healthcare personnel across the state via licensing boards and professional associations. Healthcare personnel includes Personnel working in clinical care settings where patient care occurs. This is in the inpatient or hospital setting, the outpatient setting, so offices. I've learned I have to mention dentists specifically. If I don't call out dental, it somehow doesn't get included in the rest. Home-based care, if you're a therapist going into someone's home and providing healthcare services, you're included too. It is not specific to your role. This is any person providing services or work in the clinical care setting. So this is also people who greet you and sign you in at the front desk. It's people who help keep the facility operational and the facility clean. It's individuals who help provide translation services. It's students, clinical trainees who are in that setting. So it's all healthcare personnel in clinical care settings. And this is distinctively different though from an office park somewhere where folks are perhaps coding and billing charts or doing medical administrative work. Those individuals are not in a clinical care setting where patient care occurs and would be in a subsequent phase. And we'll work on this for clarity. I have to ask all of the healthcare personnel, there are probably at least 200,000 people, if not more, in this category. I need to beg your patience. We are doing the equivalent of a World War II mobilization here, trying to bring up to speed this incredibly complex undertaking. It's going to take a few weeks, both to get the systems in place and also to get enough vaccine to reach everyone. So please, the memo today begged everyone to be patient and understanding while we ramp this all up. Turning to phase 1B, in Kentucky, we are going to include people who are 70 and older. So that's 5 years younger than the CDC recommended. So we believe here, clearly because we have such a disproportionate burden of death and morbidity in this population, we want to make it available as quickly as possible to this population. We are also going to include first responders, so think police, fire, and EMS, but emergency medical services are already covered in healthcare personnel in phase 1A. And then K-12 school personnel. This is all persons who are in the school buildings, so regardless of their role. So again, this means it's teachers. It means if you're in the school building itself, your administrative personnel, it means it's housekeeping, it means it's maintenance, bus drivers, people who are directly engaged with the students and in the learning environment or in the transportation role with the school buses would be included in this. Off-site administrative personnel, just like healthcare, are asked to please wait until a later phase. We're trying to get these locations safe, and I'll touch on this on the next slide, I think, briefly. So you can move on to the next one, James. So here are my concluding thoughts on this. And I think perspective is so important. I've told you all, I haven't told my stories for a while, my history stories. I read history because it helps put things in perspective for me. So here's a big picture perspective. Never before in human history have we had two brand new vaccines to try to help eliminate a global pandemic in less than 12 months, all right? It's a modern medical miracle. I've said that repeatedly. Deploying these new vaccines is incredibly complicated. It's federal government, state government, local government, public entities through the government, and many private partners such as CVS, Walgreens, hospitals. It will be pharmacies, it'll be medical clinics, federally qualified healthcare centers, rural healthcare centers. It's a lot of people involved. It's complex and it's going to take some time to get it up and running and efficient. It is inevitable. There will be frustrations, uncertainties, and missteps, particularly at the start, which is why everybody has to be patient. And then I mention again, just like the governor says, we'll get through this and we'll get through it together, but your patience is needed. So I'll beseech you, calling us and emailing us, we want to be responsive. We can't reply to everybody who wants to know where do you get an appointment or how do you get access. A lot of this hasn't been built yet, and it will become more apparent in the weeks and certainly in the short next couple months as they follow. So we are committed to doing this as fairly and equitably as we possibly can, getting this vaccine out as quickly as we are able. And remember, well, it makes for a wonderful story about getting this Christmas gift under the Christmas tree with these two vaccines. Trying to start up something this complicated with 2 4-day weekends back to back just only adds to the complexity. And I've spoken with my colleagues in other states, fellow state health officials. They are having the same challenges we are, just about getting systems in place, identifying populations, messaging and communicating. They're all the challenges you could reasonably expect for an undertaking this enormous, but I am confident we're going to get through this and we'll get through it together. And if we are fortunate, we may even have additional vaccines approved in the February and March timeframe. And if that were to happen, then we'll have vaccine administration sites onboarded and ready and be able to deploy them more efficiently and reach more people more quickly. And so if we're fortunate by the end of the summer, perhaps as many as half of the state who are interested and willing in getting the vaccine will have been able to be immunized by the time we enter the middle or the end of the summer. And then the people who remain will be the lower risk categories. And it's our goal to make sure everyone who wants to be vaccinated has access to it in a prioritized way as efficiently as possible. So thank you for your patience. And for all of Kentucky, thank you for your own leadership and urging your neighbors to be patient. And I would be remiss if I don't add to what the governor said before. We are in a sea of red right now for COVID. If you look around, Tennessee, when I looked last night, has the highest rate of new disease in the United States for the trailing last 7 days. Tennessee just to the south of us. Indiana had a very, very high rate. Ohio had a higher rate than us. Both, all three of those states were much higher than Kentucky. We are literally like the eye of the storm in the middle of a hurricane. And it is only going to be your actions, your voluntary choice to not travel to these other areas, to not host parties at your house that mix and match multiple people, to make sure you are keeping your social distance more than 6 feet and you're wearing your masks. Whether we sink or swim over the next 3 to 4 weeks is going to be solely determined by the choices people made the past 3 to 4 days and the choices you make this week and through the New Year's holiday. So folks, ball's in your court. We've given you the tools. We've told you what needs to be done. And now we're working real hard to deploy this incredible therapeutic to prevent disease in people who get COVID, and hopefully to prevent COVID in many other people who may not even get infected. We'll see that with time. But until we get there, ball is in your court. We need y'all to be kind and be caring and look out for each other. And the best way you can do that right now is to not spread infection by following these public health measures.